Let me start first with personal recollection. Happy birthday, of course, Thibaut, although I don't know when it was. Now, second thing, you see, we wrote with Thibaut a couple of papers. Moreover, one of the papers is incredibly cited. It's called K-inflation. And I can tell you something about story, how this paper, K-inflation, appeared. Because Thibaut was sharing office always before with one more member of EHS, Ulysses. And, okay, very nice dog was coming to seminar, sleeping, and only when speaker was going beyond any reasonable scale of logic, dog was raising his head and was saying, gav, gav. Yeah, so it was a good criteria. Normally, okay, when I was visiting EHS, I recall that was one evening when, okay, the whole thing appeared. I was sitting in comfortable chair. Next to me was dog, and I was dreaming in 2 hours, everything in Bursarabad will die because normally at 7, the city is dead. There is only one point there which is still working, Manapri. I was thinking about going to Manapri to buy a bottle of wine and spend a good evening with this bottle of wine. But you see, Thibaut usually always wants to do something. Before even we start to discuss, Thibaut already brings a lot of calculations, spoiling somehow pleasure of thinking that maybe idea is not wrong. Then it came to the title to our paper. Okay, at the beginning I said kinetic inflation, but then I discovered that somebody already spoiled the name. Then I told K-inflation. Thibaut told me, no, nobody will publish paper with this kind of title. I told him, okay, let's try. And at this point, Ulysses said, gav, gav, and then it was decided. So Ulysses, in principle, should be on the paper. But because paper collected incredible number of references, which I would never expect, although it's not my best paper, it's not the best paper of Thibaut, as far as I understand. Yeah. Then we had also with Thibaut some discussions about interpretation of quantum mechanics, and Thibaut completely agreed with me that there is only one interpretation of quantum mechanics. I will not say which one, okay, not just to damage our reputation. But then I told Thibaut, let's write some book for physicists. Thibaut said, for physicists, it's completely useless to write such a book. And this is the reason why Thibaut published this book, okay, and I have made it for you. With my picture here, the only thing actually by which you cannot recognize me is a tie, which I never carry. Yeah. So, I think it was a right movement from the side of Thibaut because physics community is so stubborn that they cannot take anything new, okay, if they were somehow in the darkness for 40 or 50 years. Now, the topic of today's talk is discrete gravity, okay? Some paper which we wrote together with Ali Shamsidin during last month. And at the beginning, it was supposed to be somehow generalization of, how now to go, actually? Wait a minute, I did something wrong. Okay. We were thinking about generalization of lattice gauge theory to the case of gravity. Okay, two words reminding or recalling to the people what does it mean lattice gauge theory. Of course, it was invention by Wilson. It's not just discretization, usual Young-Mills theory, it's something else, but in the appropriate limit, it gives you Young-Mills theory. So what you do, you make some lattice in the space, which is very definite lattice, namely you use Descartes coordinate system. Everything what I will be talking about is in Euclidean space, but you can make weak rotation, it's not the problem. And then take on this lattice a set of brackets, which I wrote here. And then with each point, okay, which connects two vertices with each line, you associate some unitary matrix. For instance, UN or SUN, and write it as exponent of some parameter A, which characterizes the size of this placket, and then A mu, where A mu after that becomes gauge fields. Point X here is the value of what will become gauge field in the middle somewhere of this line which connects two vertices. You see, and mu index is the appropriate vector which connects to appropriate vertices. And after that, you build this kind of combination related with the placket. So it's a real part of trace of the product of the appropriate matrices when you go along this placket. And it's clear that the theory which you are getting is invariant under local UN transformation, because with each vertex, you can associate some unitary matrix. And then when you are making this transformation, this object remains invariant, as you understand, okay, because appropriate matrices, unitary matrices, just cancel each other. And after that, from this object, you build the theory which has so-called redundancy with respect to an arbitrary gauge transformation. Okay, I do not know what was the physical motivation for this thing. Of course, you could use it on computers, like people are using it and claiming that they, okay, got some result in SU3, or whatsoever, but nevertheless, for instance, concerning confinement, et cetera, when you go to continuous limit, you know that you are not supposed to trust this result. Now, then we started to think that maybe we could make also lattice gravity or analog of this kind of lattice gauge theory, and there is much more motivation to think about it. Why? Because, as I think everybody would agree, we cannot check the scale smaller than the Planckian scale. Okay, and there are several reasons for that. First of all, if you will take Einstein theory and quantize it around Minkowski background, then you will find that quantum fluctuation of the metric on the scale smaller than the Planckian scale becomes much larger than unity. Therefore, there is no any point to speak about background Minkowski space there. And as Pomeranchuk, as far as I remember, was saying, in the Planckian scale, we have liquid or boiling liquid of operators. I do not know what kind of sense to make out of it, but sounds nice, right? Second reason why you cannot check scales which are smaller than the Planckian scale, because from the point of view of physics, to check some scales, you have to collide particles with the appropriate energies, okay, which would correspond to the wavelengths smaller than the Planckian wavelengths. But this would mean in the center of mass coordinate system that the total energy should be larger than the Planck mass. And in this case, of course, if interaction will be efficient, you would form black hole with radius, which is larger than the Planckian scale, right? So in some sense, there is no way actually how you can verify this smaller scale. Also, when we go to quantum field series, and we know that there is infinite number degrees of freedom, and one of the infinities, which is more relevant for this number degrees of freedom, is related with deep ultraviolet regime. You see, and as a result, there appears all this kind of quatch about super Planckian problem for cosmological perturbations, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But I do not understand actually How could you treat even the things in the scale smaller than the Planckian scale and write dispersion relations there? It's impossible. Therefore, of course, much more reasonable it would be to have finite number degrees of freedom per each volume, let's say volume of the Planckian scale. It would be much more logical. And then, okay, when for instance, universe is expanding, the number degrees of freedom or the number of self will be growing. There is nothing wrong about change of the number degrees of freedom. If I will take pencil, will break it into pieces, okay, I got more degrees of freedom, as you understand. Gravity also can do this job. And for instance, in inflation, in this case, you would have multiplication of the number of degrees of freedom or the number of cells would be just growing of elementary cells. But the main idea is to have just some kind of elementary cells, which would be indistinguishable inside, and with each cell associate, for instance, only one value for the scalar field, if you consider scalar field. But then there appears immediately some obstacles, because in lattice gauge theory, most of the people, I think nearly always, I didn't go too much in the literature, use this kind of Descartes coordinate system, rectangular cells. But we know that in general relativity, you can take any coordinate system. And in principle, it's in your hand how to divide the space into elementary cells. Then you can tell that, look, take some kind of thing, okay, and divide it in elementary cells, some kind of coordinate coverage like this one. And then associate with each cell one number. And there can be, it's very similar to what is going on, for instance, in the case when we have quantum mechanics, because as you know, in classical theory, in phase space per each cell, you have infinite number degrees of freedom, but in quantum mechanics, per each elementary cell, you have just one degree of freedom, roughly speaking, or finite number degrees of freedom, finite number of states. In quantum, in classical theory, infinite number of states in each finite volume. In quantum theory, it's not the case. But then the first idea would be just to take this kind of subdivision and numerate all these cells by integer without thinking about any internal structure. But in this case, there appears immediately question. If you just discretize your space by the point, what is the dimension of this space? Because when space consists of the finite numbers, its dimension is all finite points, its dimension is always equal to zero. Therefore, nevertheless, we still have to think about cells which have no internal structure. And for instance, in continuous limit, the dimension is defined, like D-dimensional manifold is defined as topological space for which each point has a neighborhood homeomorphic to Euclidean D-dimensional space. And in discrete space, we could use this kind of definition, which I gave here, with which mathematicians perhaps can be unhappy, but they can refine it. In discrete space, we define the dimension D, assuming that each cell has 2D neighboring cells that share a common boundary with each individual cell. For instance, if I will take two-dimensional case, because okay, it's much easier to draw, and we'll take this cell of elementary volume, then it's surrounded by 4 points. And then in D-dimensional case, I can numerate all these points by integers, by D integers, okay, which I can combine with this N alpha. For instance, if this cell I will numerate by numbers N1 and N2 in two-dimensional space, then N1 plus 1, nearby cell here, is nearby cell here, N2 plus 1 is nearby cell here, and okay, these cells are approximately here. Now, when we have the structure of cells, we could think about further structure. And for instance, I could define function. But in this case, it would be discrete function. So, for instance, it could be some scalar, which takes one value in cell N, and takes a different value in cell N plus 1. N plus 1 can be any cell. Okay, here I will skip this alpha, because formulas will be too messy otherwise. So, in some sense, as I told you, in this case, we are introducing finite number degrees of freedom per elementary cell. Like in quantum mechanics, although it's not quantum mechanics. Next thing, which we could define are so-called shift operators, which bring us from one cell to the other cell. These operators, for instance, if we defined already function, and these operators are associated with each cell, as a result of action, produce the value of the function in the nearby cell, okay? Which has common boundary with the others. Then these shift operators in the d-dimensional case form a linear space because you could define multiplication by number as sum of two operators according to this formula. You can also define inverse shift operator just moving to the cell which is on the opposite side, and alpha shows you direction here in which you have to move. Okay, so far so good. Next step. We will need also to introduce here so-called tangent operators, because after that, we will need to get continuous limit, and these tangent operators should become like tangent vector to coordinate lines, because we do not want to lose this so-called diffeomorphism invariance. And they are built within the given cell as a linear combination of shift operator and inverse shift operator. For instance, in two-dimensional case, C2 makes you difference of the functions in two nearby cells divided by two. You see? So now next step would be to introduce, of course, scalar product. And you could find, perhaps I needed to write with this formula, you can find a linear combination of these tangent operators with the coefficient, which are inverse what is called soldering form, which is just decomposition, for instance, of tangent operator in terms of this V special vectors, which are orthogonal, and which form a basis, okay? Orthogonal basis at each point, and the theory, as we will claim, should be invariant with respect to the group of rotations, okay? Which preserves this scalar product. And these vectors, which are orthogonal, orthonormal, okay? People normally call field binds or infodimensional sphere binds. So with which cell we will associate the appropriate, the corresponding field binds. And we want to build the symmetry, the theory with the local symmetry group, which will be the group of rotations, SOD, in each cell. So, okay, under this rotation, which in the Minkowski case would be just Lorentz transformation and would respect the redundancy related with the velocity of refalling Einstein elevator, right? Okay, under this rotation, the set of Fairbairn V goes to the set of Fairbairns V tilde. Okay, and the angle of rotation is, of course, continuous symmetry. The angle of rotation is determined here. Then The next step which should be done here, similar how it's done in general relativity, is to define the notion of parallel transport. If you would take these tangent operators, you would be in some trouble, because normally after that, when you would be defining, for instance, Riemann curvature as a result of commutator of two derivative of two vectors, you have to keep in mind that there is no Leibniz rule in the discretized cases. This is the reason why to determine the symmetry, real gauge symmetry, one has to use always this tangent group, okay, of this Fehrbach, because this local group in fact determines the group of redundancy. It's not diffeomorphism. Diffeomorphism is just renumeration of the point, not more. But this redundancy reduces the number of degrees of freedom to the right number of degrees of freedom, for instance, in general relativity. And when I am taking, for instance, one of the vectors from Fehrbein at point n plus 1b, yeah, and bring it to nearby point, then I will define the rule of parallel transport using so-called spin connection group elements, not spin connection algebra, because you have to understand why we have to have group elements here, because we have to exponentiate the things since it's finite shifts. And therefore, okay, we could define the element of spin connection algebra, which give you parallel transport using this formula where omega, normal spin connection, which we know is contracted with the generators of the rotation group in the vector representation here. After that, it's very easy to find the parallel transport for the tangent operators, because you just use the fact that the scalar product of Fehrbein with the tangent operators is scalar. It's not changing when you make parallel transport. And then you can express all spin affine connections in terms of spin connections and appropriate soldering form. Hello? Yeah. So this formula can allow us entirely express gamma affine connection in terms of spin connections, I mean elements of the algebra here, this omega, and appropriate Fehrbeins, soldering form at the point n in the cell n plus nearby points. So, of course, this Christoffel symbol do not contain any new information because parallel transport is already determined by spin connection. Then, if we will require that there is no torsion, then we are getting this kind of equation, which allows us to express on spin connections just in terms of soldering form in N and nearby points. Now, as I told you, the theory should be invariant with respect to local S or D transformations. And if I look how elements of the spin algebra are transforming under this group, I see that they are not transforming covariantly. It's the same story more or less when you write transformation law for the field, yeah, gauge field. And there appears extra piece with the derivative. So it's reflected in the fact that here R inverse is taken in the nearby point. But if I will build, for instance, from these elements of the spin connection algebra and shift operator, this kind of operator, then one can verify that this object is transforming covariant. This is the reason why, if I will consider this kind of expression, which is built out of spin connection elements of the algebra. This alpha beta at point n is transforming also covariantly. This is the reason why after that I can make okay gauge invariant combinations. And moreover, okay, this kind of expression respects this redundancy related with S or N group. If you would look what is this, okay, or how it's built. Then, okay, what we are doing, we are taking also some kind of placket which connects different cells and go along this placket anti-clockwise and then subtract appropriate quantity which correspond to clockwise motion. Now, automatically we are getting the object which is, of course, when we extract these two things, which is anti-symmetric in alpha and beta. So for SO3, SO2, and SO4 groups, R alpha beta could be rewritten in this more familiar form, okay, where spin connection curvature and G are the appropriate appropriate generators of the rotation group. Doesn't matter in vector representation or spinner representation. And after that, okay, we take these elements, contract appropriate indices, and we are building scalar curvature in this discretized gravity. And therefore, we can write after that immediately action, just summing over all n. There is a factor here, weight factor, which we were able to determine considering Hermiticity of Dirac operator only. I do not know how to get it differently, which satisfies this equation. And in the continuous limit, this factor becomes determinant of the soldering form. You see, so it's square root of the determinant of G. Now, equations are very complicated, which we are getting because in abstract form it's okay, but already when I try to apply or to write this equation explicitly in two-dimensional case, yeah, when all cells are numerated just n1 and n2, and I will use the freedom in the using rotation group actually and freedom in the choice of cells to set all fear binds to be equal to each other, because here there is only one fear bind, then first of all, I could rewrite spin connection, not in exponential form, but in the form, because it's SO2 group, SO2 matrix, okay, in the finite form with sine, cosine, and we can resolve the equation for the absence of the torsion. And as you see, we are getting rather messy expression for the spin connections out of which we can build, for instance, this two-dimensional scalar curvature when we substitute this thing here. Therefore, it's a lot of job to extract equations. I don't speak about solving them, but the things is here ideological from which you could start at least quantizing theory after that with the idea of having elementary quanta of the space. Now, the theory which actually... 5 minutes, yeah, I will finish in 5 minutes because as you see, transparency come to the end. You see, of course, it's very non-trivial to see that you will get correct continuous limit. We spent quite a lot of time with it. Yeah, because if you would, for instance, take some coordinate X multiplied by epsilon, and then after that epsilon, you will send to zero that all point will come to the same point. Therefore, if you want to get continuous limit, you simultaneously has to take this parameter epsilon, which determines you the typical size of the scale, send it to zero, but numbers which you use to number the cells should go to infinity. It's like shown here, right? You take a straight line, you take particular point of the manifold, you are discretizing the whole thing, then this point correspond to n equals 3, but when you will decrease the discretization, then n will become 5. So now keep the point x, but then take limit epsilon goes to 0. Then in this case, these shift operators are determined like this one, where epsilon shows you to which cell moves you shift operator, your function f from the cell numerated x. And then when you take limit epsilon goes to zero, then you see that this tangent vector, when it's applied to some function f, I think there should be f here, gives you nothing, then just derivative along appropriate coordinate line. You see? So we got this thing. And all these kind of shift operators became just tangential operators. Now, when we are defining parallel transport for the fear binds, of course, epsilon should also enter here. And then when we will take into account appropriate modification of our definitions, this epsilon non-equal one, then we are getting well-known expression for the spin connection curvature. And the action, which we have here, okay, which was sum over all cells, become just normal Einstein action. So, as I told you, it's some kind of scheme which would replace lattice gauge theory, but what to do concerning concrete calculations is actually the next step. And also, all this kind of consideration is applicable in any number of dimensions, but in two, three, or four dimensions, it's okay, all this exponent can be written down as matrices. In other cases, it cannot be done. But in fact, we do not need actually 5, 6, or 7 dimensions. I would survive with 2 and 3 dimensions because I would think that the things would be very useful if we will use Hamiltonian approach to general relativity, and then at each constant time hypersurface, we discretize the space in terms of the cells of the finite size. And then the theory will be automatically invariant with respect to this rotation group, which can be promoted to 3-dimensional rotation group. If you want to go to 4 dimensions, then the whole thing can be promoted to the local, for instance, local Lorentz group, yeah. Okay, so thank you very much.
Thank you. Other questions?
I have a question. Did you hear me?
Yeah, yeah. Yes.
Okay. From the beginning, you consider a plane with a lattice of square and the number of neighborhood cells are 4. But suppose I consider the plane with triangles or with a pentagon and penrose rule, something non-symmetric, or in 3D with a platonic solid, what happens to your periodic? This look, connection between the number of neighborhood cells will be reflected in.
No, you are not allowed to do, because you can make as many neighborhood as you want. But okay, when we are defining, for instance, dimension of the space, we are assuming that each cell has appropriate and the same number of 2D nearby cells which share the common boundary. You see, when here you are not assuming some kind of internal structure, okay? So because you don't know how to define the length, how to define the straight line, it's very different from registic, because registic assumes some kind of substructure, you see? Here, it's not the case. Here we do not know even what are the lines, you know, that you could draw it like I was doing it before, yeah? here is very curved or whatsoever, etc., etc. But of course, in principle, you could make here more cells surrounding this cell. But then you have to repeat this procedure for everything, you see. And the only justification that it works, it gives you actually very straightforward continuous limit, respect the symmetry for the continuous manifold, I mean symmetry, which is related with the local tangent group, yeah? And it was not so easy to obtain because you understand that a lot of the notions of differential geometry which you have, you cannot bring to the case of discretized space. And one of the headaches with it is that there is no Leibniz rule, okay, in the case when you are discretizing the things. After discretization of the things. You see, otherwise I could survive, for instance, with affine connection. But as I told you, affine connection in this case do not allow you to respect this kind of redundancy related with the physical freedom of taking Einstein elevators at the same point, but with different velocities, but with the same acceleration, of course. You see, this is actually the physical reason for the redundancy. If you would use just freedom and enumerating the things, it doesn't bring you too much.
Okay, thank you. I see there's a question by Nikita Nekrasov online. Maybe we can make this a quick question. Let's see.
Yes.
Hi. Please. Slava, the question is, how to see the topology change in respect to spaces of different topology in general?
About topologies, I have no idea. We didn't think yet about it. Yeah, but perhaps it could be also generalized to the case of different topologies.
But that would probably require changing the number of neighbors or maybe changing.
It will, no, in the simplest case, you know, that when, for instance, we are speaking in d-dimensional space, yeah. Even in continuous limit, we are not speaking even about topology. We are speaking about neighboring, which are isomorphic to the Euclidean space of the appropriate dimension here. You see, here, yeah. I do not know how, for instance, right away to do actually the thing for topologically non-trivial stuff.
Okay, thank you.
But it just, sorry, it just was the first step, actually. After that, I told you applications, people can think about application, but you know that it's not actually equations, of course, it's infinite differences. As you have seen, even in two dimensions, okay, they look, I would say, not very straightforward, like this one, in two dimensions in the special coordinate system, yeah, as you understand. So this is actually, but you do not need to claim that we solve all the problems right away, you see, but nevertheless, here, the idea of having finite number degrees of freedom to Planckian scale is realized somehow, and there is no trouble with it, you see. Because, as I told you, okay, you can have finite number degrees of freedom per Planckian scale, but number degrees of freedom can be growing this time.
Sure. Okay, so maybe in view of the time, let's thank Slava again.